morning. And so welcome all to the grand finale. Right, musicians? The grand finale. You're looking so sharp this morning, you know? Kudos to both of you. The grand finale as for such a time as this, empowerment series. And so, if you've been missing the nights, I'm seeing a little friend of mine in the back. I know he have missed all of the nights, but he here this good Sabbath morning. So I'm happy to have him here. But nonetheless, we are here to give God our highest praise. So once again, we say welcome one, welcome all. And at this time, we're going to stand as we invite God's presence here among us to praise him who made all of us. Shall we stand? Let us bow our heads to prayer. Almighty Heavenly Father, Lord, on this, your holy Sabbath morning, we come into your presence to worship you as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We ask that your Holy Spirit may move through this place, that a fresh anointing will fall upon us, and we'll leave here changed to go and do your work. Continue to bless the proceedings of today. In Jesus' name, amen. You may take your seat.
Good morning again.
Good morning.
We're going to turn to our hymnals, and we're going to start with number 381, Holy Sabbath Day of Rest, by our Master Richly Blessed. Asking him for saving grace. our old hymnal, and we're going to sing number 4, 5, 3. They come from the east and west. They come from the north and south, invited to join with Jesus as guests and dwell in their Father's house.
To wait.
come to. Will somebody say amen? Happy Sabbath, everybody. It's a wonderful day in the living. And I'm delighted to be here with the children of God, sitting in the presence of God to receive the blessings that come from God. This is the day the Lord has made, and we have come to rejoice in it. I don't think I need any introduction. Brother Weeks from the Bible Speaks Church, right across there, part of our district. And I've come over to Macedonia. Amen. Thank the Lord. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Well, this morning the Lord has given me the privilege to speak on this wonderful topic, and it's called stewardship. Amen. Amen. For most of us, it's just revision. For those of us who don't know, it's for our education, that we might know how we can best please God. Bow your heads with me as we pray. Father in heaven, we are delighted, O God, to be found in your courts. We are delighted, O God, to sit in your presence and to be reminded, O Father, of whose we are and who you are, and the service, O God, you demand of us for our fellow men, and the worship you demand of us of thee. So bless us with the presence and power and influence of your Holy Spirit even now. Give us receptive hearts, we pray. May we experience your power even now, we ask you, in Jesus' precious name. Amen. So we want to start today in our short discourse. I just want to let you know that this is not an exhaustive study into stewardship. I only have 25 minutes, so we're going to listen quickly, right? We're going to listen fast, and we're going to pay attention. So we begin with the book of Genesis. Genesis means the beginning. So we're going to start from the beginning. The Bible says in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 1, in the beginning, God did what? Created the heavens and the earth. So God here established himself as creator of heaven and earth. And beloved friends, throughout all Bible, God has been repeating this solemn fact that he is creator of heaven and earth. In Psalms 50 and verse 10, what does the Bible says there? It says, all the cattle on a thousand hills, thou what? Belongs to him. In Haggai chapter 2 and verse 8, the scripture says that all the silver is mine and all the gold is mine, said the Lord of hosts. In Psalms 24 and verse 1, the Bible declares that the heavens declares the glory of God, and it says that all things belongs unto God. All right? All things belong unto God. Matter of fact, we are told in John chapter 1, verse 1, it says, in the beginning was God, and God the Son was with the Father. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning was God. All things was made by him, and without him there wasn't anything made that was made. Amen. So all through scriptures, Christ is trying to capture our attention of who he is, the great God. In Psalms chapter 4 and verse 11, the Bible says there, thou art worthy to receive glory and honor and power, because thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. We back to Genesis chapter 1. God created this world, and God created the things of this world to be a blessing and a benefit to humans. He made the light. He made the sun, moon, and stars. He separated the waters from the waters. He created the atmosphere. He made the animals, the plants, and the seas, and the grass. And finally, in the sixth day, God made man in his image and in his likeness. God, before he made man, he made everything is a man's happiness, for his joy, for his peace, and for his sustenance. And the Bible says, each day, the Bible says, the morning and the what? The evening was the first day, was the second day, the third day, the fourth day, the fifth day, the sixth day. God is the one who created time. Will somebody say? Amen. God placed man in the midst of the garden. Man was on trial. Man was on probation. And man flunked in his test, in his trial. Man failed. He flunked. And God has to do a work of restoration. When man sinned, immediately Jesus stood between the dead and the living. And he said to his Father, let the punishment fall upon me. In Revelation, he's known as the Lamb slain from the foundation of this world. God has an issue. Man had a dilemma. Our dilemma was a dilemma of sin. God says, before man sin, I have provided a remedy. God set out to reconcile man back unto himself, my beloved friends. And so he gave man hope. We could read it there in Genesis chapter 3, and verse 15. God speaking to the enemy says, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed, and it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. This is the promise of the remedy that is found in one man, and his name is Jesus. Man has sinned. Now his heart become callous, his mind become darkened. He is in trouble, and God provide the remedy in Christ Jesus, who alone can give us a hatred for sin. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 9 that Jesus loved righteousness and he hated iniquity. God wants to give us not only pardon, but he wants us, my beloved friends, to be reconciled unto him and to be reconciled unto him. I say, praise the name of the Lord. God has called men in our dilemma to be co-laborers with him. God has called men and entrusted in our hands this wonderful work of reconciliation, this wonderful work of calling men and their attention to the sin-pardoning Savior. So God has given unto man an opportunity to manage. Amen? We're talking about stewardship. Adam was supposed to dress the garden. He was employed in service, in wholesome activity. God gave man the opportunity to name the animals. Man was supposed to be caretaker, managers of what belongs to God. I say, praise God from whom all blessings flow. Amen? So man was supposed to be managers. But man was also to be employed in Christian service. Worship to God and love for his fellow men. And so God instituted judgments and statutes. And one of the statutes was the issue of tithing. Amen? Tithes mean what? What does the word tithe mean? A tenth. Amen? The sacred record reminded us that Abraham paid tithes to Melchizedek. So the issue of tithing, beloved friends, is an issue that we need to understand in the end of the world. Tithe means a tenth. So, Brother Prince, if you're making $600 a week, what's a tenth? It's $60. Amen? Amen? But God wants us to give an offering as well. $60 is your tithe from $600. And that tithe is not what you care home after the government take over their portion, their levies and the medical benefits and all this kind of stuff. The 10% is from what you make. They call it the gross. Isn't it true? Amen? So after the government take out what they want to take out, you understand? We still have to pay on the gross. All right? Some of us pay our offering at half. It's depend upon your faith. All right? But I want us to remember that we can't outgive God. Amen? So God has given us one tenth. God has set aside for himself one tenth of our earnings. God has asked us to return it back unto him. But we give an offering. The one tenth is to help with the gospel ministry. So God has called us, my beloved friends, into Christian service. Amen? And God has given us that privilege and that opportunity. All right? So we are to learn as well to manage the 90%. Not true? The 90%, we have to learn how to manage that. You know, sometimes, especially, I'm going to just go down a little road. You know, women, they have on a green shoes, they want a green bag. And you want a green hat. Amen? But with that 90%, God expects us to manage well that 90%. Why is it? Let's talk together. Why is it? Because the 90% is still God's, but God gave us that privilege of learning management. Amen? Sometimes we spend money that we don't have. Amen? But the money that God has given unto us is not just to lavish on our own lusts and passions, but to be employed in helping those who are less fortunate. The poor and the orphans and the widows and the lame, they need to see the love of God exhibited in us. God is trying to help us to develop his character in everything that he does. Oh, I don't have a lot of time. Let's go to Malachi. Everybody should know this text. Malachi chapter 3. Malachi is the last book in the Bible. In the Old Testament, thank you very much. Malachi chapter 3 verse 6. What does it say there? For I am the Lord, I change not. Therefore, ye sons of Jacob are not consumed. Even from the days of your fathers, you have gone away from mine ordinances and have not kept them. Return unto me, and I will return unto you, saith the Lord of hosts. But ye said, wherein shall we return? Will a man rob God? Yet ye have robbed me. But ye say, wherein have we robbed thee? And the answer come back to us in what? Tithes and in what? Offering. So we don't rob God just in the tithes. We rob God in what? Sometimes we give the tithes and we think we have done something. All right, all we're doing is returning the tithes. But we ought to make a sacrifice that the work that God has entrusted in our hands may go forward, all right, and that we be not lacking. So the Bible says, you are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house. And prove me now herewith, says the Lord of hosts, if I will, what? Not open to you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. Beloved, the first thing you do after you have been paid is to set aside God's tithe. Amen? If you wait too late, you can be tempted to dig into it and to use it and to find excuse not to return God's tithe. When we return the first thing, our tithes, God take care of the rest. When we return God's tithes, God add the blessings on the 90%. And so, we got to be cognizant of this wonderful, marvelous gift of tithing. Now, some people say the tithing was for the old time. What does the Lord say? Matthew 23 and verse 23. What does the Lord say? Matthew 23. And verse 23. It says there, "Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you pay tithes of mint and anise and cumin, and have omitted the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, and faith. These ought you to have done, and not to leave the other undone." You with me? Christ is speaking here to the scribes and the Pharisees. They give tithes. And Christ now is endorsing in the New Testament church that tithes still have to be paid. Amen? So while we pay our tithes, we ought not to neglect mercy and judgment and the other blessings of the Lord. So we're looking at four T's. The first one is in our stewardship. We say there is what? Our tithes. The other one is our time. Amen? Our time. We read before that the evening and the morning was the first day. And the evening and the morning was the second day. God is who created time. All right? We pay one-tenth. Now here it is. In the fourth commandment, the Bible says you what? Remember the what? The Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shall thou labor and do how much of thy work? All thy work. All right? So in 6 days, God gives us 6 days to do all our work. But he requires of us 1/7. That means he is requiring of us more of our time than our resource. Because our resource is nothing left by itself except that we make ourselves available to dispense these resources. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord. All through the week we are to be working, and all through the week we are to be employed in his service. But when it comes to the Sabbath, we are to drop all tools, and we are to be making preparation for the Sabbath even before the Sabbath comes on. So God requires of us one day in a week that we can be focused, that we can worship, that we, by our love for him and obedience towards him, acknowledge him as creator. For the Bible says, "For in 6 days the Lord the what? Made heaven and earth and all that in them is." St. Paul says in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 14 to 16, "Awake thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee life. Seeing that you walk circumspectly, not as fool, but as wise, redeeming the time, for the days are what? Are we living in evil time? And what are we to do to redeem the what? Redeem the time." Now redeem means to what? To buy back. We can't buy back time. What's gone 5 minutes ago is gone. Naturally, it's gone. So what's the Bible is talking about? Forget about yesterday. Forget about what's past. Make sure that you understand the times. Make sure that you understand your mission. Make sure that you understand your Christian stewardship and walk in the light that shines from heaven's throne. That's what it means. Time gone cannot be redeemed. How do we spend our time? All through the week, as we get up in the morning, the first thing is to do what? Get on our knees. My beloved friends, the spirit, the flesh indeed is weak, but we have what? Willing spirit. Amen? This corruptible flesh cannot do what God will us to do. But we need the power and grace of God daily to face the challenges that we will encounter each and every day. Amen? We need the word of God in our lives. Amen? We need the word of God in our lives when we are talking to God in prayer. Amen? That's our thoughts towards him. Amen? He speaks back to us where? To his word. That's how we form a relationship. That's how we are instructed. That's how we seek God. Amen? Job wrote in Job 23 and verse 12, "I esteem the word of his mouth more than my necessary food. In Jeremiah 15, verse 16, thy words were found, and I did eat them, and thy words was a joy and rejoicing of mine heart. And the psalmist wrote in Psalms 119 and verse 9, Psalms 19 and verse 9, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By doing what? Taking heed thereunto unto thy word. And verse 11 says what? Thine word have I, what? Hidden in my heart, that I might not sin against you. Beloved friends, the word of God is life. And we need that life day by day. We need that life afresh every morning. If you're going to stand the trials, if you're going to stand against temptation, if you're not going to be deluded, we need the life-giving word. St. Paul says in Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 11, the word of God is what? Quick and powerful. The word quick means it's alive. The word of God has power to keep us. Word of God has power to strengthen us. And we have three more minutes. I told you all, we can't do an exhaustive study. And the other T is talent. Christ gave the parable of the talent in Matthew chapter 13. You can read Matthew 25 verse 13 to 20 of the talents. To one servant he gave one talent. To another servant he gave how many talents? Two. And to another servant, how many talents? Five. Amen. He gave five. But the one with the one talent went and buried his talent. And the one with the two talents went and he what? Multiplied them. He was engaged in active Christian service. And as we go out in active Christian service, God will give us strength. He will give us more opportunities. You'll be a blessing to more people. But if you sit in quietude, not being on our Father's business, we are in trouble. We are in trouble, my beloved friends. So I just want us to understand that while we await the coming of the Lord, we are not to sit idle. Every day we're passing with people. Every day we're passing with people who are hell-bound. People who are going to our Christless graves, and we become careless and indifferent towards those who are hell-bound. God wants us to revive and to remember who we are and to remember our higher, noble, and sacred calling. And the final T is to learn how to take care of our body temple. Then Paul says that we are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in our bodies and in our spirits, which are God's. We are bought by the blood of Jesus. We belong to Christ twice, at creation and at redemption. All men are bought by the blood of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. In Genesis chapter 1, the last minute, can I take one more minute? In Genesis chapter 1, God gave us the original diet, plant-based food. When man sinned, in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 18, God added the vegetables. Amen? Amen? Amen. And he gave us the vegetables because he knew that sin was going to mess us up. Sin was going to make us unhappy, unholy sometimes, and unhealthy many times. So God supplied that natural remedies. In Psalms 104, verse 14, he says that God gave us herbs for the service of man. In Leviticus 11 and Deuteronomy 14, God permitted man to eat clean meat. But in these last days, my beloved friends, God is leading us back to Eden. He's leading us back to his original plan. I wish I had time to give you testimonies of folks who the Lord has used me to help, who the doctors have given up upon. Not I. God did it. When I go doing my medical missionary work, I believe what God says he's able to perform. Amen? So I just want to encourage us. This is one of my favorite topics to speak, the gospel of health. I came to this church one time, and the doctor could help me. I could hardly walk, and I began to learn this message. You taught me this message. When I say you, this church taught me this message. I've been there taking acupuncture for 6 weeks, nearly every other day, trying to get my back restored. I did chiropractor, trying to get my back restored. I did tablets from Dr. Singh. They sent me to Puerto Rico, brought me back here. The Lord led me to this church. I begin to learn the gospel of health, and today I don't have 1 inch of pain in my back. Not even this, beloved friends. God knows what she's saying. He knows what he's doing. And I'm not boasting upon me. It's about God. Amen. I want to thank you all for your attention. I wish, you know, I had an hour so we can present these things in an... Amen. 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 I wish we really had an hour. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your presence, Lord. Lord, time was not enough, but Lord, these are your people. We are just revising. I believe that most of us here know all these things. Oh God, but you have reminded us this morning that we are yours by creation and redemption. You reminded us, dear God, that, Lord, it is required of us, oh God, to be stewards and to be faithful stewards. And we know, dear God, that you're coming again soon. You will pronounce the benediction. Well done, thou good and faithful servants. Lord, we know that you can't lie. So help us to be faithful. Help us to be fruitful. And help us, oh God, to understand who we are. Your creatures, help us to understand who we are, stewards of what belongs to you. Help, dear God, that we will not idle our time away, but we'll be on your business. So grant us revival, grant us reformation, grant us your peace and your power. Thank you for the blessing which you have blessed us in Christ Jesus. Is our prayer with thanksgiving in Jesus' name.
Come on in. The room grew still as she made her way to Jesus. She stumbled through the tears that made her blind. She felt such pain, some spoke in anger, heard folks whisper, there's no place here for her kind. Still on she came, through the shame that flushed her face, until at last she knelt before his feet. And though she spoke no words, everything she said was heard, as she poured her love for the master from her box of alabaster. And I've come to pour my praise on him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and I dry them with my. The cost of the oil in my alabaster vault. I can't forget the way life used to be. I was a prisoner to the sin that had me bound. I measure into a little treasure box. I thought I found until the day when Jesus came to me and healed my soul with the wonder of His touch. So now I'm giving back to Him. Oh, the praise He's worthy of. I've been forgiven, and that's why I love Him so much. I've come to pour my praise on Him like gold from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash His feet with my tears and I dry them with my hair, my hair. You weren't there the night Jesus found me. You did not feel what I felt when He wrapped His loving arms around me. Yeah. You don't of the oil. Oh, you don't know the cost of my praise. You don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster.
Amen. You understand why music will be in heaven? I don't know what part I'm going to sing, but I know I will be singing. Happy Sabbath, everyone. And we're going to be talking about the Sabbath now, proper Sabbath observance. I have my PowerPoint, but technology is not working, so we'll go straight ahead. I would have loved for you to follow with me on the screen, but we'll go nonetheless. I have just about 20 minutes. Okay, I'll try and time myself. Shall we bow our heads? Loving Father, we just want to thank you for this holy Sabbath day of rest. As we are about to go through this short discourse on Sabbath observance, we pray, O God, that it will be a life-changing example for us. For some of us, it's a reminder. For some of us, it's a new path. Be with us all, we pray. Amen. Proper Sabbath observance. To maintain proper Sabbath observance, we need to be mindful, brothers and sisters, of the reason and the purpose for such an expectation. The Sabbath was designed by whom? God. God designed the Sabbath, and it was to constantly direct the mind of men and women to His created works and to remind us that who is Creator. Let us turn to Exodus chapter 20, Exodus chapter 20, 8 to 11, and it says,
"Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou nor thy son nor thy daughter, thy manservant nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it.
Okay, so in keeping the Sabbath, it was a reminder to prevent idolatry, infidelity, irreligion, and irreverence. God instituted the Sabbath to be a source of benefit and a blessing to human family. What do I say? It was to be a benefit to the human family. It is an eternal gift of love from God to man. Mark chapter 2, verse 27, what does it say?
And he said unto them, the Sabbath was made for man and not man for the Sabbath.
So what? The Sabbath was made for and not man for the Sabbath. Let's go to Leviticus chapter 23 and verse 32. Let's see what he says.
It shall be unto you a Sabbath of rest, and ye shall afflict your souls. In the ninth day of the month at even, from even unto even, shall ye celebrate your Sabbath.
Exodus 16 and verse 5, it says,
and it shall come to pass that on the sixth day they shall prepare that which they bring in, and it shall be twice as much as they gather daily.
Okay. So the Sabbath begins when? Come on, we are good students of the Bible. The Sabbath begins when? On the sixth day. The sixth day, which is what? Friday. When? Sunset. Let's clarify something here. Sunset. Now, normally, the sun sets just around 6. Give and take. Sometimes, or most of the times. Right? But the Sabbath does not begin at 6. It begins at sunset. It says, evening at sunset. Therefore, it simply means, in proper Sabbath observance, it means that all your cooking should be, come on, work with me, all your cooking should be, house cleaning should be, washing should be, ironing should be, all secular work should be finished before the Sabbath begins at sunset. Now, it is proper, it is sensible to warm your food on the Sabbath that is already prepared on Friday. Okay? Let me repeat it. It is proper to warm your food, to heat your food. Sensible. It is sensible. You don't want to poison yourself on the Sabbath, right? Okay? And the bacteria, those of us who understand foodborne illnesses, and Sister Jeffers could testify to that, the good nurse. So it is proper and it is sensible to warm the food on Sabbath that you would have prepared on. Okay, amen. Here we go. Now, all secular books should be laid aside. Magazines. No newspaper. No observer newspaper on the Sabbath. What do you say? No radio, secular radio. Right? Huh? No point newspaper, somebody says. Right? And I know you love the snake pit. No snake pit on the Sabbath. I'm keeping it real. None of that on the Sabbath. After the Sabbath hours, on sunset Saturday, then you can go and you can do such. Let's go to Isaiah 58, verses 13 and 14. Isaiah 58, 13 and 14.
If thou turn away thy foot from the Sabbath, from doing thy pleasure on my holy day, and call the Sabbath a delight, the holy of the Lord, honorable, and shalt honor him, not doing thine own ways, nor finding thine own pleasure, nor speaking thine own words, then shalt thou delight thyself in the Lord, and I will cause thee to ride upon the high places of the earth, and feed thee with the heritage of Jacob thy father, for the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it.
So this would also include business transactions. No business transactions on the Sabbath, such as grocery shopping, banking. You don't slip across to the ATM and do your withdrawal. No rent payments, right? No paper boy, right? And it simply means if you are going to ask your brother or your aunt or a nephew to buy the brownie bread today for tomorrow, you might as well go and purchase it yourself. It's a poor witness for us to send out people to do transactions for us on the Sabbath, to get things from the market for us on the Sabbath. And you are sick all week, and you know you need to see the doctor. You don't go to work, try to tough it out Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Friday, knowing well that you're going to go to the doctor on the Sabbath. That's not an emergency. You planned it. You tough it out so that you can clock in, and you're going to use the Sabbath to go to the doctor. Well, that's between you and God. You didn't fall sick Friday evening. Now, parties, socials, or the secular activities, football, cricket, tennis, should not be engaged in God's time. Let me say this. Those of us who are employers, we ought to ensure that on Friday we dismiss our workers early enough, especially those of us who are employers of Seventh-day Adventist brothers and sisters, the contractors. By 12 o'clock at least, pay your workers so that they can go home and do what they have to do. Give wifey the money so that she can do what she has to do before the Sabbath comes in. Sabbath morning is not the time for you to be trying to get the sawdust out of your hair. Sabbath morning, yes, I'm saying it. Sabbath morning is not the time for you to be trying to get all the sawdust out of your hair. Sabbath morning is not the time for you to be doing your manicure and your pedicure. Amen? Amen? It is an excellent opportunity for you to enjoy the handiworks of God. You can study nature. You can visit the sick. Now, it doesn't mean that you're going to delay visiting the sick only on Sabbath, because the sick need your visit during the week as well. They need your prayers during the week as well. Right? It is a good time for you to do Bible study. Let's look at 2 Timothy 2:15 quickly. 2 Timothy 2:15.
Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth.
So the Sabbath is a good time for you to study the Bible, it's a good time for you to review your quarterly as well. God is pleased when we refrain from not only labor, but also from speaking our own words or thinking our own thoughts on the Sabbath. Isaiah 58 and verse 13 bears that out. Right? We show disrespect to God when we sleep away the Sabbath hours and refrain from worshiping. We show great disrespect to God when we sleep away the Sabbath hours and refrain from worshiping in the house of God. Now, there is no harm in taking a little rest, a little nap on the Sabbath, but the Sabbath is not for you to sleep away. We honor God by gathering our families together in prayer and singing in a worshipful attitude at the beginning and at the close of Sabbath. Do we still do that? Do we still honor God at the beginning of the Sabbath? Amen, amen. Do we still honor God at the beginning, at the close of Sabbath? And do we know, this might sound funny to some, it would be sensible if we can have AY finish in time so that families can be together at home to close off the Sabbath. It's not salvific. Let's not make an issue out of it. But it would be sensible if we plan properly, manage our Sabbath services properly, so that we can still have AY. We do not want to sacrifice AY, but we be out of church and be home as family so that we can close the Sabbath. What do you say? Do you agree with me? Amen. Amen. In agreement. We're wrapping up quickly. God has designed the Sabbath to be the happiest day of the week. However, in order for this to be so, the day must be remembered all during the week. Amen? If this is going to be happening, we must remember the day, all day of the week. Then special preparation should be made on the sixth day in order to be ready to welcome and observe the Sabbath when it comes. So when do you begin to pray for the Sabbath? When? Right. So all tomorrow, you're preparing for the Sabbath. And then on Friday, your final wrapping up, you're completing everything. The Bible indicates that all secular employment should be done away with. We said that. It also declares that all purchases should be made before the Sabbath. Nehemiah 13, 15 to 18 bears that out. In connection, anything which would take our minds from the things of eternity should be set aside for the deeper joy and the greater pleasure that can be found in Jesus Christ on the Sabbath. Isaiah 58, 13 and 14. Sabbath keeping helps to discipline our minds and focus our attention on the God of creation and not on the creature ourselves. It's all about God and the worship and the remembrance of Him as creator. Amen. The seventh day Sabbath keeps reminding us where we came from and who we are and whose we are. Amen. The Sabbath ought to be observed as a day of delight. The Sabbath ought to be observed as a day of delight, sacred pleasure rather than a day of obligation. It's not a day of obligation. It should be seen as a day of do's rather than do not. One more minute. And Sabbath observance, brothers and sisters, brings blessings, not pain and suffering. Some people can't wait for the Sabbath to come, while there are others who can't wait for the Sabbath to end. My mind, it brings the Sabbath brings physical rest, but more so, it brings spiritual blessings, spiritual rest, spiritual blessings to the one who observes God's holy Sabbath day of rest.
Good morning, church. We serve an on-time God, correct? We serve an on-time God, correct? Amen. So I pray that no matter what you're going through, when it seems as if everything is about to fall apart, remember God is always on time.
The news came to Jesus, please come fast. Lazarus is sick, and without your help, he will not last. Mary and Martha watched their brother die. They waited for Jesus. He didn't come, and they wondered why. The death watch was over, buried 4 days. Then somebody said, he'll soon be here, the Lord's on his way. Martha ran to him, and then Lord, if you had been here, you could have healed him. He'd still be alive. But you're 4 days late, and all hope is gone. But isn't it great when he's 4 days late, he's still on time? Jesus said, Martha, show me the grave. But she said, Lord, you don't understand, he's been there 4 days. But the gravestone was rolled back. Then Jesus cried, Lazarus, come forth. Then somebody said, he's alive, he's alive, he's alive. You may be fighting your battle of fear. You've cried to the Lord, I need you now, but he has not appeared. Friends, don't be discouraged, 'cause he's still the same. He'll soon be here, he'll roll back your stone, and he'll call out your name. When he's 4 days late, and all hope is gone, it's not yours or mine. But isn't it great when he's 4 days late, he's still on time? Oh, my God is great when he's 4 days late, he's still on time.
Happy Sabbath to everyone, and amen, amen, and amen again. These are your notices for today, Sabbath, the 28th of October, 2023. We have a letter from the South Leeward Conference, dated October 26, 2023, and it reads, Dear brethren, we are grateful to God for his protection and guidance during the passage of the recent hurricane. Notwithstanding the fact that Barbuda experienced the eye of the storm and hence the strongest winds and rain, we are happy that there was not significant damage. God continues to protect and care for his children. As a result of the threat of the storm, last week's Let's Talk program was canceled. We will resume at 3 p.m. this Sabbath afternoon when I will be in discussion with Dr. Dane Abbott on the subject of infertility. This is an area that is of great significance to many. I wish to take the opportunity to express a happy 42nd anniversary of independence to the people of Antigua and Barbuda. We have much to thank God for. We still enjoy relative religious liberty, and we live in an environment of relative peace. Sunday, October 29th, is the National Independence Church Service. It will be held at the Ebenezer Methodist Church on St. Mary's Street, St. John's. I wish to encourage the brethren to take the time to join in this special moment of thanksgiving as a nation for God's blessings on us all. God's blessings and a happy Sabbath to all. Yours in faithful service, Carson L. Green, President. For other notices, it's a praise celebration, an unforgettable night of worship. Get ready for reignition of praise on November 25th at 7 p.m., a youth gospel concert featuring an electrifying Jamaican gospel group, Agape. Spread the word and stay tuned for more information. Applications are invited from suitably qualified persons for the following positions at the South Leeward Conference Headquarters, custodian and facility or grounds maintenance worker. Please note that the Adventist Possibility Ministries Blind and Low Vision Task Force World Sight Day, I fear, has been postponed until further notice. Adventist Possibility Ministries Day, featuring the seven areas of emphasis: the deaf, the blind, the physically immobile, those who have mental health challenges, orphans or vulnerable children, those mourning the loss of a spouse, and the support of caregivers, will be recognized on November 18, 2023 at the Bible Speaks Seventh-day Adventist Church, Creekside, beginning at 9 a.m. All pastors, elders, personal ministries leaders, Sabbath school leaders, and members are invited to an important evangelism training on Friday, November 17th at 7 p.m. and Sabbath afternoon, November 18th at 4 p.m. via Zoom. All stewardship leaders are asked to take note that November 26th to December 2nd, 2023 is Stewardship Week. November 18th to 25th, 2023 is Men's Week across the South Leeward Conference. The Breast Cancer Awareness Presentation, hosted by the Women's Ministries Department, will take place, that is tomorrow, Sunday, October 29th at 5 p.m. via Zoom. The second annual Pathfinders Bible Connection will take place on Sabbath, November 4th, 2023 at 3 p.m. at the New Bethel Seventh-day Adventist Church. All Sabbath school superintendents and secretaries are invited to a planning meeting on Zoom platform tomorrow, Sunday, October 29th at 10 a.m. Registration for the 2024 International Pathfinder Campery is ongoing and will close on October 31st, 2023. On December 16, 2023, the Youth Department of the South Leeward Conference will launch its Drop It initiative. Special shirts to be worn on the Drop It initiative will be available. The deadline for ordering shirts is October 31st. Detailed SLC notices have been placed in the church's WhatsApp chat. For the local notices, all are invited to Bible study tomorrow, Sunday, 29th October at 7 p.m. Join us as we get closer to God through the study of His Word. The church's early morning prayer meeting will continue on Tuesday and Thursday of the upcoming week from 5 a.m. to 5:30 a.m. via Zoom. All are invited to our midweek prayer meeting on Wednesday, 1st November at 7 p.m. Branch Sabbath School will continue next Sabbath at 9 a.m. Week of prayer begins next Sabbath, 4th of November, with prayer and fast, and ends with communion on the 11th of November. Join us on Sabbath at 9 a.m. and nightly at 7 p.m. for Be His Witness, Week of Prayer with guest speaker Johann Babb. All are invited to return today after the baptism for a grand fellowship lunch. Then we bring the curtains down this afternoon at 4:30 p.m. for the closing ceremony with the final word from Evangelist Aline and a mini concert. All are invited to come out. You cannot afford to miss this. Birthday greetings are expressed to those who celebrated during the week. May the Lord continue to bless you, keep you, and give you peace. Please receive daily updates by joining our WhatsApp group, by contacting Pastor Challenger, Elder Edson Joseph, Brother Orin Steele, or myself, Sister Renata Joseph. Thought for the week ahead. As we go through the upcoming week, let us find comfort in the words of Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. It doesn't matter how dim our situation may be. Let us be assured that our future will look brighter with God. Let us be determined to exercise faith in God, and He will deliver us. A blessed Sabbath to all.
It's time for our praise and worship section.
Amen.
We're going to start with, I love you, Lord. I love you, I love you, I love you, Lord, today.
One more time,
let it be a sweet.
Let it be a sweet.
because of his amazing grace. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see.
Where?
stand as we sing our theme song? Mike, my God is awesome. He can move mountains, keep me in the valley, hide me from the rain. My God is awesome.
Church family, happy Sabbath. Memory verse today is a scripture reading, is taken from Luke 19, verse 10. And I will read in your hearing. For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. Amen.
Let us say amen for the young man who read the scripture reading. We asking you to bow your heads at this time as we lift our hearts in prayer to God. Wherever you are, we're just asking you to touch somebody. Musician, pray very softly as we get ready for prayer. Come on, people, touch somebody. Touch somebody. Pray, Father, we come one more time knowing that you are prayer answering God. We are mindful of the strategies of the enemy, but we also remember and know that you are all powerful. You have said in your word that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, against rulers of all different mindset in this world. But right beneath that verse, dear God, you have given us the prescription to overcome. You said that we should have the gospel and we should be prepared and we should be always praying, dear God. As a matter of fact, you said unto us, watch and pray. Father, at times we don't know what to look for. At times we don't know how to pray. For I've learned from the disciples, they have been with you, around you, and listening to you. And one day they exclaim, Lord, teach us how to pray. Father, most times when we come to you, we come to you for things. We want this and we want that, but seldom we ask that you reveal yourself unto us. And Father, if we should pray by asking you to reveal yourself unto us, if we should pray by asking you to teach us how to spread your word, if we should pray, dear God, by asking you how to advance your gospel, Lord, I believe we will be a better people. Because, Lord, in our answer, the answer to our problems does not lie with the requests we have. It's lie in looking and seeking after others. Because sometimes the request is when we are on your way. Lord, this evening I lift Jennings Church. This morning I lift Jennings Church before you. Father, like all the other churches in the world, all the other Seventh-day Adventist churches, it has its problems. But Lord, you are the great problem solver. Oh Father, only you can come within the pew and touch your members. Father, some may have to say, Lord, create in me a clean heart, oh God, and renew a right spirit within me. But Lord, we know, as your man servant in your word said, that when we come, dear God, we must lift up each other in prayer. Father, heal your church. Bring your church together. And Lord, as painful as it may be, sometimes you have to separate the sheep from the goats. Oh Lord, you said in Ephesians that you are coming back for a pure church and without spot or wrinkle or any such thing. It means, therefore, that the persons inside of your church worldwide would have no spot nor wrinkle. But we don't know how to clean your church. You have to clean your church. As a matter of fact, dear God, we don't know who is sheep from who goat. But Lord, you have to treat us to treat everybody like sheep. Lord, I pray for this community. Lord, this community has so much potential. But Lord, the devil is within this community in various forms. Wherever there is disunity, wherever persons or section is causing disunity, that is not of God. And Lord, we need to identify and point out the devil and sin for what it is. Lord, last but not least, I lift those who will be giving their life to you this morning. For those who are here, we want to thank you for responding to the call, for making that brave step to secure your salvation before it is too late. For those who are in the valley of decision, if you are here, it's an indication that you should go all the way with Jesus. If you are online, it's an indication that you should go all the way with Jesus. And Father, I pray that you bless the speaker one more time. And Lord, I'm not asking for blessings. I'm coming to the point, dear God. May you anoint her mind. May you take a life coal from the altar symbolically and rest it on her tongue, so that when she speaks, dear God, it will be through via the Holy Ghost that men and women will be touched and be ready to receive translation. And as your Holy Spirit go through this congregation, may you touch our hearts and prepare us to receive your word. This is our prayer. Let everybody online and in this congregation say amen and amen. Amen. Please be seated, everybody, in the house of the Lord.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. Isn't it a delight to be in the house of the Lord? We're going to ask that the ushers take their place as we prepare to collect the morning's tithe and offering. Let us bow our heads for prayer. Gracious God, it's an immense joy when you would allow us to work 6 days, toil and labor, and you would bless us, Lord, with financial blessings. We ask, dear God, that as we go and collect the tithe and offerings on your behalf, that you would bless, and bless even those who are unable to give at this moment. We ask that the tithe and offering will go out to preach the word and to bless other hearts out there. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, sing "Give" and it will come back to you.
Give and it will come back to you. Good measure, pressed up, shake it together and run it over. Give and it will come back to you. When you give to the Lord, give and it will come back to you. Good measure, pressed down, shake it together and run it over. Give and it will come back to you. When you give to the Lord,
when you
give and it will come back to you. Good measure, pressed down, shake it together and
everyone. I have a poem entitled "For Such a Time as This." Time is running out, my friends. This world as we know it is coming to an end. It just seems to be rolling on, paying no mind to the final trumpet's call. Missing a night means you missed a lot. The spirit has been at this very spot. Every night, Sister Aline brings the truth with style and charisma, creating roots. These roots will ground you in the word, preparing us to live happy and pure. Our dash is based on our own choice, lived at its best if we listen to the Master's voice. So whether you are on your Gaza Strip or you're living in spiritual bliss, remember, obedience is better than sacrifice. It is the only thing that leads you to Christ. In a few hours, the curtains will come down, every soul on their journey to attain the crown, weighing on the scales of justice an opportunity that came for such a time as this.
Happy Sabbath celebration, Jennings. Oh, praise the Lord. It's a joy to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Praise the Lord. Natasha Brown-Alleyne loves the Lord, loves people. Her favorite text is Philippians chapter 4, verse 13. She's host of the Adult Lesson Study Panel on ASI Media Tobago YouTube channel. She is an ordained elder. She is also a lay evangelist, motivational speaker, author of Walking on Water, a powerful, life-changing, inspirational devotional book, and a company journal available directly from the author or on Amazon. She is also a lawyer by profession, wife of an international evangelist, Roger Alleyne. She grew up in the fishing village of Mayaro in Trinidad. He grew up in the fishing village of Charlotteville in Tobago. Together, they are fishers of men in team ministry. What a team. Holder of two bachelor's degree in business management and law, respectively, and a master's in law, among other qualifications. Church, I present to you none other than our speaker, Natasha Brown-Alleyne.
Happy Sabbath, Church. This morning, I want you to know that the God we serve is a powerful God. No matter what you're going through, just trust God. He will work it out.
God's word is true. God's word is powerful. It has come to me for such a time as this. God's word is deep. It chases after love surrounds me for such a time as this. Holy Spirit, fill me. Holy Spirit, transform me. Such a time as this, prepare me, oh Lord, for such a time as this, prepare me, oh. Time as this.
Happy Sabbath, everybody. How's everyone doing today? Wonderful. So it's good or great during the week, but on Sabbath it's wonderful. Amen. God is good. And all the time. How good is God? In Tobago we say, real good. So let's try that again. God is good. And all the time. How good is God? Real good. It's my pleasure to welcome you, to greet you in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who is awesome, amen? He is beautiful. Despite the struggles we may face in life, he still remains God. He still remains good, amen? So welcome to one and all our pastors who are visiting with us, all our lay evangelists. Everybody here from Jennings, give me a wave. Neighboring churches. My good friend, Ashra and Josephs, who have been transporting us most times. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for your love and your support. All Saints has been coming out from so far. Sister Charmaine is always here, and she's here today in her bright yellow. And her lovely daughter next to her. Online viewers, we greet you as well. Crusade team, thank you. As we get prepared for the final message entitled The Final Warning, breathe a prayer in your heart that God will speak his word and that you will hear a word directly from God today. Stand everywhere with me, with Bibles in hand, in your right hand, and even if you don't have your Bibles, please stand and raise your right hands as we declare together, Holy Spirit, we are in your presence. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Let us pray. Father, we give you all the glory. We give you all the praise. Come by here. May we feel your presence today. Hide me behind the cross. Take full control of this moment. Take full control of your daughter. Without you, I am nothing. But with you, all things are possible. Speak to somebody's heart today. Some young man, some young woman, some child, some older person. Just speak to each of us today. May we each leave here with a word from you. It's our prayer with thanksgiving. Amen and amen. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Praise the Lord. The final warning. Warnings are there to help us prepare for something that is to come. Am I right? Meteorologists put out warnings when a storm or hurricane or other national disaster is forecasted. I'm sure you in Antigua and Barbuda know what I'm talking about, yes? Because while I'm here, we experienced it for last week's forecasted Hurricane Tammy. Weather advisories is the first type of warning. It is color-coded yellow. And it means be aware. Something is brewing, but they are generally not considered life-threatening. The second type of weather warning is called a weather watch, and it is color-coded orange. It means be prepared. These are more important warnings that describe phenomena that can develop into severe and even extreme weather conditions over time. Such a warning should not be ignored. And as the name implies, you should watch and be prepared for events that they are telling you about. The third type of warning is called, the first one is a weather advisory. Second one, a weather watch. Third one, a weather warning. Color-coded red. It means take immediate action. These are the most important warnings and tell you that some extreme weather conditions are brewing. Unlike the previous two types of warning, this one is the final warning and a call for specific action. Let's go in our Bibles to the book of Genesis. What book did I say?
Genesis.
And the chapter is 18. So go in your Bibles with us as we read together verses 20 through 24. What does the word of God say, reader?
Genesis chapter 18, verse 20, reading onwards. And the Lord said,
yes.
Because the cry of Sodom and Gomorrah is great, And because their sin is very grievous, I will go down now and see whether they have done altogether according to the cry of it, which is come unto me. And if not, I will know. And the men turned their faces from thence and went toward Sodom. But Abram stood yet before the Lord. And Abram drew near and said, Will thou also destroy the righteous with the wicked? Peradventure there be 50 righteous within the city. Will thou also destroy and not spare the place for the 50 righteous that are within?
So let us pause there for a moment. Mm-hmm. So Abraham, having been warned by God that Sodom and Gomorrah is to be destroyed, Abraham began to plead with God.
Yes.
Intercede with God on behalf of Sodom and Gomorrah. Mm-hmm. He asked God, peradventure, there be 50 righteous people. Will you destroy the city? In verse 26, the Lord said to Abraham, if I find in Sodom 50 righteous within the city, then I will spare all the city for their sakes. Abraham continued, what about if you find 45 righteous people? Will you destroy the city? God in his mercy said, if I find there 45, I will not destroy the city. Abraham continued his pleading in verse 29. Lord, what if you find 40? Mm-hmm. Will you destroy the city for 40 righteous mm-hmm. people?
Tell us.
The Lord in his mercy said, no, I will hold my hand. I will not destroy the city if I find 40 righteous people. Mm. Abraham continued his pleading in verse 30. Lord, what if you find 30 righteous people? Notice the numbers are
decreasing.
What if you find 30? Will you still destroy the city? The Lord said, if I find 30 righteous people, in my mercy, in my love, I will spare the city. Mm. Abraham continued pleading with God on behalf of the city in verse 31. Lord, what about 20 righteous people? If you find 20, would you still save the city? The Lord said, yes, if I find 20 righteous people, in my love and in my mercy, I will spare the city. Mm. Abraham continued pleading. He dropped all the way to 10. Lord, what about if you find just 10 righteous people? Would you still spare the city? The Lord said, if I find 10, I will spare the city. Mm. Verse 33 of Genesis 18, and the Lord went his way as soon as he had left communion with Abraham, and Abraham returned unto his place. Friends, I've come by here to remind you that God is love.
Amen.
I've come by here to remind you that God is merciful.
Amen.
I've come by here to remind you that God is compassionate.
Amen.
I've come by here to remind you that God is forgiving. I've come by here to remind you that God is long-suffering.
Amen.
It is on this premise that Luke 19:10 says Jesus came into the world to do what?
Seek and to save that which was.
To seek. And to save that which was
lost.
Because God does not want anybody to perish. Mm-hmm. In John 3:16, he declares, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Amen.
God loves us.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amos 3:7 says, surely the Lord God will do nothing, but he revealeth his secret unto the servant, the prophets. Mm-hmm. And that's why he revealed it unto Abraham. And Abraham interceded on behalf of Sodom and Gomorrah. Lord, if you just find but 10 righteous people, will you destroy the city? Can I tell you that not even 10 righteous people were found in Sodom and Gomorrah?
Have mercy.
E.G. White tells us, it is a solemn statement that I make to the church. that not one in 20 whose names are registered upon the church books are prepared to close their earthly history.
Have mercy.
And would be as verily without God and without hope in the world as the common sinner. They are professedly serving God, but they are more earnestly serving mammon. This half and half work is a constant denying of Christ rather than a confessing of Christ. Why is this so, my friends? Because many of us, we come to church, but we haven't come to Christ.
Have mercy.
Not one in 20 whose names are on the church record are ready to close their earthly history. When I read that, as they say, your knees get weak. You are just hoping that you are that one in 20. But it's a sad reality, but a great awakening for the church. It is time to shake up.
Yes.
It is time to get up. Mm-hmm. We are in church, but we are not in Christ. We come to church Sabbath after Sabbath, Wednesday night, Sunday night, and it's like the messages are going from one ear through the other, and we are not being transformed. Why is this? The devil, my friends, has a strong grasp on us. Can I tell you how?
Tell us.
Through money. We are focused so much on worldly pleasures. Worldly things. I'm not saying do not get a house, do not get a car. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying do not get an education. I'm not saying that. But I am saying to seek first the kingdom of God.
Amen. Amen.
And his righteousness.
Amen.
And all these things shall be added unto you.
Amen.
Friends, we need to begin to detach from this world.
Amen.
I'm speaking to church folks this morning. We need to begin to detach from this world. I've told you before that we are living, we are dwelling in grand and awesome times. I told you that Jesus is about to come. And the sad reality is we are not ready.
Have mercy.
If Jesus were to come today, are you ready to meet your Lord?
Savior.
Do you have any closet sins? Any secret sins? Could I tell you that those things that are in secret will come to light? What does verses 1 to 8 of chapter 19 tell us, reader?
And there came two angels to Sodom at evening.
Yes.
And Lot sat in the gate of Sodom.
Uh-huh.
And Lot, seeing them, rose up to meet them.
Mm-hmm.
And he bowed himself with his face towards the ground.
Uh-huh.
And he said, behold, now, my lords,
uh-huh,
turn in, I pray you, into your servant's house. And tarry all night.
Read with the reader.
And wash your feet.
Mm-hmm.
And he shall rise up early and go on your ways.
And they said,
and
what?
They said, nay, but we will abide in the street all night.
Yes.
And he pressed upon them greatly, and they turned in unto him. and entered into his house. And he made them a feast, and did eat baked unleavened bread, and they did eat. But before they lay down, the men of the city, even the men of Sodom, compassed the house about, both old and young, all the people from every quarter. And they called unto Lot, and said unto him, Where are the men which came into thee this night? Bring them out unto us, that we may know them. And Lot went out at the door unto them, and shut the door after them, and said, I pray you, brethren, do not so wickedly. Behold now, I have two daughters which have not known man. Let me, I pray you, bring them out unto you, and do ye to them as it good in your eyes. Only unto these men do nothing, for therefore came they under the shadow of my roof.
Angels Amen. Visited Lot's house to give him the final warning, to bring him and his family out of the city before destruction. But the word of God says that wicked men of the city, notice the Bible says both old and
young,
from every quarter came to Lot's house, not to throw a welcome party.
No, no.
But to know the men as Adam knew Eve. In other words, the men wanted to have sexual relations with the men.
Ouch.
Romans 1:26 and 27 says, For this cause God gave them up unto vile affections, for even their women did change a natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burnt in their lust one to one another, men with men, working that which is
unseemly,
and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was meet. But could I tell you, we are beaten up on Lot's day, but our day has become just as Lot's day.
Yeah, so true.
On all levels, young and old are involved in wickedness.
Yeah.
Men are having sexual relations with men. That is the parallel that is happening with our day and Sodom and Gomorrah's day. Brother Joshua, I see you. Welcome. God will not stand idly by. He did not stand idly by in Noah's day. He did not stand idly by in Lot's day. And he will not stand idly by in our day and see sin continue.
So true, so true.
He will one day put an end to sin.
Yeah.
And everyone who is found with sin will sadly be destroyed.
So true.
When Jesus comes again, I told you before that there will be four classes of people. The righteous dead, the righteous alive, the wicked dead, and the wicked living. Four classes of people. I just want to be righteous, dead or alive.
Amen, amen, amen.
Amen. It doesn't matter, dead or alive, I want to be just righteous.
Amen. Amen, sister.
Because my Bible assures me, brother, that even if I die in Christ, I shall be resurrected.
Amen. Amen.
For the righteous, death is but asleep. I told you before, for the righteous, death is a comma.
Yes.
It only places a pause. pause. Because when Jesus comes, I will rise again.
Amen. Amen.
But they couldn't find 10 righteous people in Sodom and Gomorrah.
Have mercy.
But I am grateful. I believe it all my heart that right now in Antigua and Barbuda, there are more than 10 righteous people.
Amen. Amen.
Were it not for the righteous people in Antigua and Barbuda, trust me, Tammy would have hit all your heart.
Yeah.
Many times a city or a country is spared things. It is because of the righteous people, the praying people.
Amen, amen, amen.
What does verses 9 through 11 of Genesis 19 tell us? Let's read together.
And the angel said, stand back. And they said again, this one fellow came into sojourn and he will need be a judge. Now will we deal worse with thee than with them. And they pressed sore upon the man, even Lot, and came near to break the door. But the men put forth their hand and pulled Lot into the house to them, and shut to the door. And they smote the men that were at the door of the house with blindness, both small and great, so that they wearied themselves to find the door.
Don't miss the point. They were already wicked. And blinding them did not make a difference. It did not bring them to consciousness, my sister. The Bible says they wearied themselves to find the door. Blind or not, come out here. That's the height of wickedness. Can I tell you that the devil has blinded many eyes today? In so much that they don't even understand the depth of wickedness in which they have found themselves. It has become so normal to them.
Have mercy.
They are living in darkness. Spiritual darkness. And don't even know it. But I've come by here to call Antiguans and Barbudans out of darkness into God's marvelous light.
Amen.
Can I tell you that when you're in the light, you can see clearly?
Amen, amen.
My friends, we need to do our part as Christians to share the light. Jesus didn't just say, I am the light. He went on to say, you are the light. Go and shine forth. Do not hide your light under a bushel. Let everybody know that you are a Christian. Let everybody know that you are a Seventh-day Adventist. The reality is that many of us, even in our workplaces, they don't even know what religion you are.
Ouch.
Because sometime during the week, Seventh-day Adventists, come on, we need to get up. We need to stop the double standard life. Sometimes during the week, we are wearing earrings to go to work.
Yeah.
And chains. And then on Sabbath, we take them off and come to church.
Yeah.
Our nails are all colors. Our eyelashes are 1 inch.
Have mercy.
Friends, we need to do better than that.
Yeah.
Worldly pleasures vainly call me, but I will be like Jesus.
Amen.
Yes, it looks good. But I say like the psalmist, I am fearfully and wonderfully made.
Amen.
I don't need no extra fangle and dangles to look pretty. I'm already pretty in Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
Young ladies, you don't have to wear them things to be a cutie. You're done natural already, natural beauty. You're done royal already. You don't need all them things.
Amen.
That when you take them off, the man don't even know who he was with last night.
Have mercy. Ouch.
Natural beauty. Mm-hmm. God gave us it already. And truth be told, tell me men, ain't all you prefer them natural?
Yeah. No artificial flavors.
No artificial flavors.
No artificial flavors.
Reader, continue with me from verse 12 of Genesis 19. What does the word of God say?
And the men said unto Lot, hast thou here any besides son-in-law and thy sons and thy daughters and whatsoever thou hast in the city? Bring them out of this place.
For we will do what? Hear the final warning.
For we will destroy this place.
Yes.
Because the cry of them is waxen great before the face of the Lord. And the Lord had sent us to destroy.
Let us read over verse 13 together. For we will destroy this place.
Because the cry of them is waxen great before the face of
It's waxen
of
what?
Great.
Great.
Before the face of the Lord.
Yes.
And the Lord has sent us to destroy it.
Mercy.
Lord has sent us to destroy it.
Friends, there is coming a time when the Lord will not hold back the winds of strife. Destruction is pending. This is the final warning. And Lot went out, verse 14, and spake unto his son-in-laws, continue.
Which married his daughters.
And he said what?
Up.
Get you out.
Of this place. Mm-hmm. For the Lord will destroy this city.
Yes.
Because he seemeth as one that mock unto his sons-in-law. Mm-hmm. And when the morning arose,
the angels
hastened Lot, saying, mm-hmm. Arise, take thy wife and thy two daughters, which are here, lest thou be consumed in the iniquity of the city.
Go to verse 17.
And it came to pass when they
let's
had
read
brought.
Verse 16. Let's read verse 16 to verse 17.
And while he lingered, the men laid hold upon his hand and upon the hand of his wife and upon the hand of his two daughters, the Lord being merciful unto them. And they brought him forth and set him without the city. And verse 17, and it came to pass when they had brought them forth abroad that he said, escape for thy life. Look not behind thee, neither stay thou in all thy plain. Escape to thy mountain, lest thou be consumed.
My friends, Lot went to his sons-in-laws. He told them what was happening, and they did not respond favorably. You notice his sons-in-laws were not with him when they left. I want to talk to people today. When the call is made, I want you to come. Escape for your life. Lot was lingering to save him. God in his love and his mercy, the angels held Lot's hands and he pulled them out.
Yeah.
Some of us are so hardened, so stubborn. Call after call, night after night, and we sit in our seats as stiff as board. The angels had to hold Lot's hands and pull them out.
Yeah.
Today you might have to hold somebody's hand to save them and bring them to this altar.
Oh yes, amen, amen.
Unless God does some of that, for some of us, we will be lost.
Yeah.
Unless he doesn't hold our hands and pull us out, we will be lost. Today God has sent me here to hold some hands.
Yeah.
And to call some folks to escape for your life, because destruction is coming. Your life depends on it. Abandon sin. Abandon the things of this world. Take your families and escape for your life. Do not look back. Look forward. Backward never. Forward ever.
Amen. Amen.
The things of this world are pulling us so strongly. And instead of looking up from whence cometh our help, we are looking back. Looking back at what? What does verse 18 say, reader? And Lot said unto them, Oh, not so, my Lord. Verse 19, continue.
Behold now, thy servant hath found grace in thy sight.
Yes.
And thou hast magnified thy mercy, which thou hast showed unto me in saving my life. And I cannot escape to the mountain, lest some evil take me and I die. Verse 20, behold now, the city is near to flee unto, and it is a little one. Oh, let me escape thither. It is not a little one, and my soul shall live.
And verse 24 says, then the Lord did what?
Rained upon Sodom and upon Gomorrah.
What did he rain?
Brimstone and fire.
From the Lord out of heaven. And he what?
And he overthrew those cities.
Yes.
And all the plain, and all the inhabitants of the cities, and that which grew upon the ground.
But what?
But his wife looked back behind. Let me read it again. But his wife looked back from behind him, and she became a pillar of salt.
Lot's wife looked back. She was so hooked on the things that were happening in Sodom and Gomorrah.
Mm-hmm.
She was supposed to be among the righteous, isn't it?
Yes.
That's why I told you before, some of us are in the church, but not in Christ. She was among the righteous. She was already almost out of the city. But the worldly pleasures had her so strongly that she looked back one more time. Let me get one more look. Sometimes, that one more look, that one more touch, that one more fet will cause your detriment.
Yes, that's true.
I just want one more party.
Mm-hmm.
On your way home, dead. That's exactly where the devil wants to have you. Just one more. I'd rather have Jesus.
Amen.
Than anything this world can ever give. Have come to know in my short life here on earth that money, as much as it answered all things here, it cannot buy salvation.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
Have come by here to tell you that no matter how many letters you have behind your name, it doesn't matter in heaven. The reality is you're going to get a new name anyway.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
So it wouldn't matter in heaven. Too many of us are looking for accolades this and accolades that and doctor this and doctor that. But friends, can I tell you that sometimes, we are doing all these educational pursuits and our spiritual life is dwindling. Because we have no time to study God's word.
Ouch.
I have an assignment to do.
Mm-hmm.
So we wake up in the morning, 2 minutes prayer, rush to do your assignment.
Yeah.
You're going to bed 12 o'clock at night because you have an assignment to do.
Mm-hmm.
But if we ask you to spend 20 minutes in prayer,
it's too long.
Start to fall asleep.
Mm.
The things of this world are so strong. Colossians 3:1-2 tells us, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are
above,
where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affections on things above, not on things on the earth.
Amen.
I've told you before that things down here are fleeting.
Yeah.
Things down here are temporary.
Mm-hmm.
They will not last forever. The only thing that matters then is that your life is wrapped up and tangled up in Jesus.
Amen, amen.
Where is your family today? Lot escaped only with his two daughters, not even his wife. Let me speak to some husbands today. I know sometimes these women could be a little troublesome. It's true.
It's true.
But men, can I ask you, in your personal devotion, to pray deeply for the woman in your life?
Amen. Amen.
You see, women are very emotional.
That's correct.
And sentimental.
That's correct.
So perhaps Lot's wife was thinking about her wedding album.
Mm-hmm.
Can I tell you that my wedding album is in my emergency kit?
It's true.
I told you that women are sentimental. Don't lie to yourself. So pray for us, men.
Yes, we will.
Pray for us.
We will continue.
That God will transform that into something stronger on the spiritual level.
Yes, we will.
That we will be able to keep those memories in our minds and not necessarily in a photograph that we have to take with us.
Mm-hmm.
Because the reality is they can't go nowhere with you.
Yeah.
Men, pray for the woman in your lives.
We will.
Woman, let me talk to you. I know we don't like to hear the word submit, but woman, submit to your own husband.
Amen.
Had she submitted, she would have been looking forward and she would have been saved.
Yeah.
But she looked back.
Mm-hmm.
Because the things there were more important to her than her husband and her children.
Mm-hmm.
Can I speak to children?
Yeah.
Obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right.
Yeah.
Thankfully, these two daughters were at that time obedient to their father. So they could have been spared the fire and the brimstone.
Yeah.
I want to welcome Pastor White. Friends, God wants to save families.
Yes, indeed.
In Noah's day, how many were saved?
Eight. Yeah.
Could I tell you that no children were saved in Noah's day?
True. That's true.
How many were saved in Lot's day?
Three.
Could I tell you that no children were saved?
Correct.
Why is that? That's an indictment against parents.
True. So true.
Parents, train up your child in the way that they should go, that when they are old, they will not depart from the truth.
Amen, amen.
I know some parents who have trained their children so well that even as adults, and Sister Ashra, they will say, yes, mommy.
Yes, mommy.
And go.
Mm-hmm.
But there are some children, they are at 9 years old, and you tell them, let's go, and they ask you, why?
Mm-hmm.
and they tell you, I don't feel like going. Long time you had no feel like you was going. When mommy tell you, let's go, you say, which clothes, which outfit you're upon? And you just go. Children, your parents are there for a reason.
Yeah.
God placed them there to guide you into heaven.
Yeah.
Take their guidance. Parents, take your responsibility seriously. Even if you have no children, take responsibility for your nieces, for your nephews. For children at the church, because they are all our children.
Amen.
God wants to save families.
Yeah.
Is your family right now saved?
Question.
Husbands, pray for your wives. Wives, pray for your husbands. Parents, cover your children when you wake up on mornings. The devil is out to destroy our children.
Yes, so true.
I told you that no children were saved in Noah's day. No children were saved in Lot's day. But we want children to be saved in our day. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
What does verse 27 of Genesis 19 tell us, Rita?
And Abraham got up early in the morning to the place where he stood before the Lord. And he looked toward Sodom and Gomorrah and toward all the land of the plain. And he beheld, and lo, the smoke of the country went up as the smoke of a furnace. And it came to pass, when God destroyed the cities of the plain, that God remembered Abraham and sent Lot out of the midst of the overthrow, when he overthrew the cities in which Lot dwell.
And Lot, can I tell you that God remembers you? Once you are faithful to him, God remembers you.
Amen.
He will call you out. He will come for you. You just be faithful to him and God will do the rest.
Yeah, what a God we serve.
God remembered Abraham. God did all he could to save Lot and his family.
Yeah.
The portion of Lot's family that were lost on their own account.
Yes.
Not for a failing on God's part. The reality is, if any one of us are here that will be lost, if we are lost, we'll be lost on our own account.
That's true.
Not on any failing on God's part.
That's correct.
God has done all he could to save us.
Yes, he has.
The final warning is out. This world will soon be destroyed. Soon God will say, the wickedness of this earth is too much. Let us go down and destroy earth. And everyone that had sin will also be destroyed.
Yeah.
Sodom and Gomorrah had reached an unprecedented height of evil that to that date could have only been compared to Noah's day. That's why the Bible says in Luke 17, 26 to 29, and as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be also in the days of the Son of Man. They did what?
Eat. They drank. They married wives. They were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and the flood came and destroyed them all. And verse 28, likewise also as it was in the days of Lot, they did eat, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they built.
But
the same day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. It was so sad.
As in the days of Noah, as in the days of Lot, so shall it be in the end. Many people are just running behind material things and worldly pleasures, forgetting that there is a God, forgetting that there is a judgment to face, forgetting that there is an eternity to gain and a hell to shun. There are only two destinations, two trains. One leads to heaven and one leads to hell. Which one are you boarding?
Heaven.
Can I tell you that our boarding pass is determined by how we live our dash?
Yeah.
If you want to board the train to heaven, then you must live your life for Jesus.
Amen.
And just like when we are in a hurricane, a final warning, my friends, the shops are closed and you cannot get anything. Can I tell you that there will come a time when you cannot get anything, including the word of God?
True, so true.
There will be a famine in the land, not just for food and water, but for the word of God.
Amen.
Crusade tents will be no longer.
Mm-hmm.
Churches will be closed. Evangelists will be out of duty. Your probation will be closed.
Yeah.
Then what will the verdict be? Saved or lost?
Lost.
Would you be on God's side or the devil's side? Jesus left the splendor of heaven, knowing his destiny was Calvary. And he did it just for me. I wish I could sing that song. Just for me. Could somebody help me sing that song? Just for me. Jesus came and did it. Come on, somebody. Patrice, Ashra, Cherise, somebody. Jesus came and did it.
Just for me.
Thank you. Give him a mic.
Just for me.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus came.
Jesus came and did it just for me.
Hallelujah, he did it just for me.
Just for me. Just for me. Oh, Jesus came and did it just for me.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, my brother. Jesus came and did it just for me. God sent the angels into Sodom just for Lot and his family.
Yes.
Noah preached 120 years, but only him and his family were saved.
Yeah, just
husband, come here. Husband, come here.
What? Okay. Just for me.
I'm determined to go to heaven with my husband.
Amen. 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 Amen.
Families, 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 you are here right now.
Mm-hmm.
Hold each other's hands. Determine right now that you will be going to heaven with your family.
Yes.
And if peradventure someone in your family is here and they are not baptized, when I make the appeal, bring them to this altar.
Amen. Amen.
Jesus wants to save families. And until God blesses us with children, this is my family.
Amen.
And we'll be going to heaven
together. Amen.
No turning back.
Mm-hmm.
No turning back.
Mm-hmm.
We have decided to follow Jesus.
Amen.
No turning back. No turning back. Do I have some families here who have decided to follow Jesus? No turning back. No turning back. Stand with me everywhere, everybody. Stand with me everywhere, everybody. Keep holding the hands of your family. Keep holding the hands of your family. I will follow thee, my Savior, wheresoever thy lot may be. Whoever thou goest, I will follow. Yes, my Lord, I'll follow thee.
Amen.
You have already decided. You have already decided to follow Jesus.
Amen.
We have some persons who have already given their names down for baptism. Uh-huh. And you are here. Can I ask one of your family members to bring you to this altar? Mommy, you know your son has already given her their names. You know your daughter has already given her
Amen.
Name. Bring
Amen.
Them to this altar.
Amen. Amen.
Cousin, you know your cousin has given their name, whatever is your relationship, but you know they've already put down their name for baptism.
Amen.
Bring them to this altar.
Amen. Amen. Come on,
because
just
God wants
together.
To save
put
families. Let's put our hands together. Hallelujah. A mother is bringing her son. A mother is bringing her daughter.
Brothers are walking together.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. As we sing that song, if you know you have not yet given your life to God, bring your daughter, bring your son, parents. Your children are growing up in this church and they are not yet baptized. Bring them to Jesus. Yes, my Lord.
Yes, my Lord.
I'll follow thee.
I'll follow thee. I will follow thee, my Savior.
Hallelujah.
Thou didst shed.
Thank you, Lord, for shedding
thy
your
blood
for
me.
Hallelujah.
And the
thank you, Jesus. A sister is bringing her sister.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
I'll follow thee, though the road be rough and thorny.
Oh, it doesn't matter. I'll follow thee.
Trackless as the foaming sea.
Hallelujah.
Someone else is
come on. Somebody else is coming. Glory with
Amen.
God with us.
This way
thank you, Jesus.
Me.
Yes, my Lord.
And
I'll gladly
follow thee.
Yes.
I will follow thee,
my Savior.
Thou didst shed
thy blood
for me.
And though all men
should forsake thee.
By thy grace. I'll follow thee. Let's pause there, just the music in the background. Young men, God wants young men. He wants young men to continue this gospel. He also wants young women to continue this gospel. Do I have a young man or a young woman today who wants to declare, I will follow thee, my Savior, wheresoever thy lot may be? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
You are not yet at this altar, but you know the Spirit is speaking to you. Come by this altar. Young man, listen to the voice of the preacher. This just might be your final warning. Wednesday night, Pastor Dr. Green told us about a 15-year-old girl. They invited her to a 4-week crusade. She did not even go one night. She made it clear to them that she was too young. She wanted to party a little more. She wanted to live life a little more. Can I tell you that the crusade ended? She did not attend. But about a week later, Pastor got the sad call. She was rushed to the hospital. Mm-hmm. And she eventually 15-year-old girl thought she had her life in front of her, thought she had time. But can I tell you, you do not have time. The only time you have is right now.
No.
If you hear his voice, harden not your hearts. As the next verse is sung, I want to invite you to come.
Though I beat with tribulations, sorely tempted though I be, I remember thou wast tempted and rejoice to follow thee.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
I will follow thee, my Savior. Thou didst shed thy blood for me. And though all men should forsake thee, by thy grace I'll follow thee. Though thou lead affliction or forsake,
though I be. Thou wast destitute afflicted.
Thou wast destitute afflicted.
And I only follow thee.
And I only follow thee.
Oh, sing the song, I will follow thee, my Savior.
Follow thee, my Savior.
Thou who did shed thy blood for me.
Shed thy blood for me.
And though all men.
And though all men should,
forsake thee by thy grace.
By thy grace.
I will follow thee. Oh, there are much more people that should be here. You know that you have given your name for baptism. This might just be your final warning. Come by here before it is too late. Death can come suddenly and then that's it. There is no other opportunity. No other opportunity. Today, if you hear his voice, harden not your hearts.
Come.
Fathers, come. Bring your children. Mothers, bring your children. Grandparents, bring your children. Husbands, bring your wives. Sisters, bring your brothers, siblings, bring your sibling. Come on, families. God wants families to be saved.
Amen.
Do we have another?
Is there someone else upstairs who would like to come?
Yes.
Do we have another? Online, we plead to you. This is your time. We are going to Small Fries. I think it's on this direction. Right. We are going to Small Fries. So we are asking you, I've called some persons and they ask where we will be having the baptism. So we are going to Small Fries. So if you are online, we are heading to Small Fries in a little bit. Is there another? Father, mother, is there another? You are here. Is there another?
Permit me to make an appeal.
Is there another?
To backsliders. You have been walking with Jesus, but you know things have gone awry. Mm-hmm. And you are not walking the way you should be walking. This is your opportunity to rebaptize and recommit your life to God. Amen. Do not let this series close. Amen. Say praise God for
praise
this young
God.
Man.
Praise
clap
God.
Your hands. I am always happy when I see praise young God. People give their lives to the Lord. I'm happy when I see everybody give their lives to the Lord. but more so young people, because you know right now the world is so crazy, snatching all young people into all kinds of craziness. So when God gets them early, he's able to work with them and save them. And the generation will be better for it.
Amen.
You always do yourself well when you give your children to the Lord early.
Amen.
I told you already, I got baptized at the age of 10. And I have not looked back.
Amen. Amen.
I've loved Jesus with all my heart ever since. Did I make mistakes?
Yeah.
Yes. All of us will make mistakes.
Yeah.
But my Bible says if we confess our sins,
he's faithful.
He is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Is there another? We linger this morning just for you.
Just for you.
Just for you, we linger a Amen. Little longer.
Amen.
Hallelujah. A mother brings a daughter. We linger for a young man this morning. We linger for a young woman this morning. We linger just for you. Is there somebody else who will come and join this beautiful throng to the front here?
Is there another?
One more for the Lord.
Is there another young man? Calling young men this morning. Is there another young man? Is there another young man? Are you coming, sir? All right, is there another young man? We need young men in the church. We need young men to carry God's gospel. Come, young man, I want... Come 1 second. Yes, come.
Is there a young woman for Jesus this morning?
We need young men like him.
Amen.
He stood here this morning and gave us the scripture reading.
Yes.
We need them young.
We need children.
So we can train them.
Yes.
And they will go and preach the gospel. That's in the religious world, but they would also represent Jesus in this world that they are living in.
Yes.
So we need them young. I didn't have the opportunity to be a young guy like him in the Adventist church, but I remember when I used to go to the Methodist church, young like him, I have to put my hands together and say some long recitation. I guess that's why God has blessed me with a good memory. But we need young men like him. God bless you. And you're going to stay right here as we pray. So you're going to give all the young men the courage to do great things for the Lord. So you just stay right here with us. Is there another before we close? Is there another?
Can I speak to some adults? You've already... lived out most of your life, most of your dash. You're in your 30s, in your 40s, in your 50s, in your 20s, your 60s. Come by this altar. Give the rest of your life to Jesus. Mm-hmm. Jesus wants to save you too. Adults, come to this altar.
Yeah.
Yes, the Bible says that children would lead them. But we need adults in the church to guide these children.
Amen.
So could I ask you, man, woman, to come by this altar this evening? Come by here and give your life to Jesus. You've already seen it all. And we can conclude, as did Solomon, all is vanity.
Yeah.
So come and give God the rest of your life.
As you bow your heads and as we pray, we're asking all those persons to the front, just touch somebody.
Yes.
They're right to the front. Just touch somebody. Touch somebody.
Hallelujah.
Let us pray. Almighty God, indeed heaven is rejoicing. For there are many men and women, boys and girls at your altar, ready to give their lives to you.
Yes.
Oh Lord, we thank you for the presence of your Holy Spirit moving upon their heart. Yes. For Father, this is the sealing time.
Yes.
You are sealing men and women for your kingdom.
Hallelujah.
But they cannot be sealed unless they walk to the altar and give their life in baptism. Oh Lord, and as they come, I claim Ephesians 4:30, which says you will seal them unto the day of redemption.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Father, as they go down into the watery grave of baptism, help them to realize that every sin that they have ever committed in their life will be forgiven.
Yes.
Will be washed away.
Oh, praise God.
The weight that they are feeling, the burdens that they are carrying, dear God, they will leave it right in that water.
Thank you, Jesus.
The uncertainty of the future, Lord, they will walk out of that water certain.
Yes.
Not with assurance, not with insurance, but assurance, dear God. Knowing that Jesus, if anything go wrong with their life, they are secure in you.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
So, Father, as they stand before us, I know that the devil is going to torment them even at this time, but I pray, dear God, that the precious blood of Jesus cover their life.
Cover, Lord, please.
Seal your people. Help no one that has walked to the altar to turn back.
Oh, please, Lord, please.
Father,
Lord.
From experience, we have realized that some will go and ask, and there are persons who will say, you're not ready, but Lord, once we hear your word, we are ready. For the Bible says today, if you hear his voice,
harden not your hearts. Hallelujah.
Lord, we remember Esau. The Bible says that he sought you with tears for repentance, but did not find it.
Ah, mercy.
Lord, they have walked to the altar.
Yes.
Seeking repentance.
Yes.
Grant it unto them, O Lord.
Hallelujah.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen and amen.
Hallelujah.
We are asking those were standing and those were supporting to stay right here as Pastor White will come and read the vows for you. We're asking the congregation to sit. Please be seated. But we are asking those who are here and even those who are supporting, just stay right here. If you can't stand too long, we are asking you to sit. But we want you to stay at the altar. And fathers and mothers, I really want to commend you.
Amen.
I really, really want to commend you.
Amen.
For walking with your children. Please put your hands together for the mothers and the fathers.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
With their children.
Amen.
Who walk with their children. Pastor.
Praise the Lord. Somebody say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
There is still power in this gospel. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
I say
amen.
There is still power in the everlasting gospel.
Amen.
And today we rejoice what the Holy Spirit has accomplished through our maid servant, and we are very happy for God's power. We're going to do the traditional vows, and those of you who will be baptized, we want you to say, I do. You're going to say it so loud that the people way at the top have to hear you. So once I make the statement, which is in the form of a question, you will just shout, I do, because today you're getting married to Jesus. And when they shout, I do, those of us who are already baptized, you're going to say amen. You're going to say hallelujah. You're going to be excited for them. So we go from the top now. Number one, do you believe there is one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, a unity of three co-eternal persons?
I do.
Amen, amen. Number two, do you accept the death of Jesus Christ on Calvary as the atoning sacrifice for your sins and believe by God's grace through faith in his shed blood you are saved from sin and from its penalty?
I do.
Somebody say amen.
Yes.
Do you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior and believe that God in Christ has forgiven your sins and given you a new heart, and do you renounce the sinful ways of the world?
I do.
Praise the Lord. Do you accept righteousness by faith, and that at the fact that Jesus Christ is your intercessor in the heavenly sanctuary, and accept the promise of his transforming grace and power to live a loving and Christ-centered life in your home and before the world. Somebody say amen. Do you believe that the Bible is God's inspired word, the only rule of faith and practice for the Christian? Do you covenant to spend time in regular prayer and Bible study? Somebody say praise the Lord. Do you accept the Ten Commandments as a transcript of the character of God and the revelation of his will? Is it your purpose by the power of the indwelling Christ to keep this law, including the fourth commandment, which requires the observance of the seventh day of the week as the Sabbath of the Lord? Somebody say amen, amen. Do you look forward to the second coming of Jesus and the blessed hope when this mortal shall put on immortality? As you prepare to meet the Lord, will you witness to his loving salvation by using your talents and your personal abilities through soul winning to help others to be prepared for his coming? Praise the Lord. Do you accept the teachings of spiritual gifts and believe that the spirit of prophecy is one of the identifying marks of the remnant church? Amen. Do you believe that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit and you will honor God by caring for it, avoiding the use of that which is harmful, abstaining from all unclean foods, from the use, manufacture, and sale of alcoholic beverages, from the use, manufacture, and sale of tobacco in all of its forms for human consumption, the use and misuse and trafficking of narcotics and other drugs? Amen and amen. Do you believe and understand the fundamental beliefs taught by the Seventh-day Adventist Church? Do you purpose by the grace of God to fulfill your life in harmony with the principles of the Adventist Church? Amen and amen. And this is the one you're going to shout a loud amen for. Do you accept the New Testament teaching of baptism by immersion and desire to be baptized as a public expression of your faith in Christ and his forgiveness of your sins? Somebody say hallelujah today. And finally, do you accept and believe that the Seventh-day Adventist Church is the remnant church of Bible prophecy, and that every people of every nation, race, language are accepted into its membership? Do you desire to be a member of the local congregation of the Seventh-day Adventist Church? Somebody say amen today. Put your hands together for them. Put your hands together for them. I'm going to ask a baptized member of the Adventist Church, a baptized member of, I said Adventist Church, it could be any Adventist church, to stand now and move the motion. And you're going to move a full motion. We're not just going to stand and say, I move a motion. You're going to say, I move the motion that these individuals be accepted as members of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, subject to their baptism. Somebody move that motion. The young lady at the back. Wow. I'll make no statement on that. Move the motion. Go ahead. We'll be members. Adventist Church. Subject to their. Somebody say amen. It's moved. Is it seconded? Wow, there are plenty seconds. All those in favor, do so by the lifting of your right hand. As you look, turn around those who are getting baptized. Look at all these hands. Put your hands together for them. Our God is awesome. There is power in the word. Thank you, woman of God. Our God is so tremendous. We're going to ask the church clerks, Bible workers, and those responsible to deal with the baptismal passes. We're going to let you fill out the baptismal passes right now. So let's get members of the praise of the crusade team can come and help. Let's get all of them to fill out the baptismal pass now. And while they're filling out the baptismal passes, let's get all our secretaries, elders can come and help. As they fill out the passes, we're going to get ready for prayer and go to the baptismal site.
We'll have a praise team by the time do this. Let's have our praise team sing a song while we...
All right, so we want every person who's getting baptized. Come, We have a lot of passes. We have a lot of passes. So just distribute them for us. We have plenty passes today. Let's distribute them for us, that everybody has one in their hand. And as they're doing that, as our evangelist says, we're going to sing a song. Once they're finished with that, we're going to pray and go to the baptismal site. Let's get that song as the Bible workers and the elders come. On this side too, on this side, the person's here too, to get the passes. Go right ahead.
We'll sing, "I Have Decided to Follow Jesus." I have decided to follow Jesus.
To the instructions we're going to